Hello everyone, I am Dr. Aravind. Today we will discuss about adverse drug reactions, then general principles of treatment of poisoning, then treatment of alcohol and OPC poison. Okay, then adverse drug reactions. What is adverse drug reactions? Initially, for any kind of disease, we will give tablets like drugs. For example, fever, we will give paracetamol. So in that paracetamol, it will clear the fever. So that one is our expected response. Okay, but at the same time, maybe like sometimes it will produce some allergic reactions or our liver damage can happen. That is adverse drug reaction. That adverse drug reaction we don't want, but sometimes it can happen. That is ADR. It's a pharmacodynamics of the drug. Pharmacodynamics means what is the drug does to the body. If you're taking the drug, how it will act in our body and how it will produce the effect. That is pharmacodynamics. In that, it can happen both either desirable or beneficial effect. That is, taking paracetamol for fever, it will reduce the fever. That is desirable or beneficial effect. Maybe it can produce some allergy or liver damage like that, or kidney damage. That one is called undesirable effect or adverse drug reactions. So here, undesirable effect or ADR, we can divide them into three categories. First one, expected undesirable effect, that is type A. Second type, unexpected undesirable effects, type B. Then other types, type C, D, E, F. So here expected means, okay, we will expect it may happen like that. Then unexpected, we won't expect this kind of side effect will happen or not. Then other types we will talk about later. In the expected undesirable effect type A, there are three categories of effect. First one, side effect. Secondary effect, toxicity. Here in unexpected, hypersensitivity or allergy, because some people may develop allergy, but some people they won't get allergy. So it is an unexpected undesirable effect. Hypersensitivity, then genetically determined adverse drug reactions, then idiosyncratic response. Idiosyncratic means there will be a cause, but the exact mechanism we don't know. That is idiosyncratic response. First, we will see about the expected undesirable effects. Type A, A for augmented effect. So augmented effect means it is mostly predictable because it is expected. So we will know what will happen after taking the drug. So it is mostly predictable and it is a dose dependent. So if you reduce the dose, you can minimize the adverse drug reactions. In that, as I already told, side effect, secondary effect, and toxicity. First one, side effect. Side effect, it is an undesirable effect even at the therapeutic dose of the drug. Okay, 500 mg drug we are giving, even at the dose itself, it will produce some side effect. It is usually mild and manageable. For example, dicyclomine, if you are giving for the intestinal colic, there will be a more abdominal pain because of intestinal spasm. For that, we will give dicyclomine. So in that, it will produce a dryness of mouth. That is a side effect, even at the therapeutic dose. Next, a secondary effect. Secondary effect, it is a kind of another one effect. So primarily, it will produce a original effect. Secondarily, it will produce some other effect, like an indirect consequence of the main drug. For example, corticosteroids, we are giving for allergy. But at the same time, what it will do, it will reduce our immune system, because reduced immune system, it will produce infection. That is a secondary effect. Okay, then toxicity. Toxicity is an exaggerated form of side effect, like due to overdose or prolonged use of the drug. Keep on giving the drugs or overdose if you are giving, it will produce kind of toxicity like aminoglycosides, gentamicin, streptomycin. If you keep on giving, it will produce ototoxicity and then nephrotoxicity. Like a heparin overdose, if you give over heparin, it will produce bleeding, that is toxicity. Next, unexpected undesirable, unexpected. So it will occur unexpectedly, like bizarre effect. B type B, B for B, bizarre effect. So bizarre effect is somewhat different. We can't expect this kind of side effect will happen like that. It is relatively uncommon. In case if it occurs, its mortality rate is high. So the mechanism is unrelated to the main mechanism of the drug because the drug have some other mechanism for the therapeutic action. But the side effect, this undesirable effect, its mechanism is different from the main mechanism of the drug. Here the dose reduction won't help here. Then in that category, hypersensitivity or allergy, genetically determined ADR and idiosyncratic responses. We will see one by one. First one, hypersensitivity reactions. You all know hypersensitivity or allergic reactions. Like first the person taking the drug, okay, first time he will escape. At the time, the drug will induce antibody in our body. So again, if you're taking the drug, it will produce allergic response. So allergic responses will happen when the sensitized patient is re-exposed to the same drug. So if you're taking the drug again, at the time you will get allergic responses. So those affect urticaria, rhinitis, pruritus, then asthma, sometimes anaphylactic shock also can happen. In that anaphylactic shock, there will be a bronchoconstriction, laryngospasm because of anaphylaxis. Then there is a laryngeal edema. Then finally, the patient may die. That is a hypersensitivity reaction. So there are four types of hypersensitivity reactions. 1, 2, 3, 4. A type one is a immediate IgE-mediated hypersensitivity. It will develop within a minute. It will develop within a minute and it will last for 2 to 3 hours due to IgE antibodies. These IgE antibodies, for example, this allergen is a drug. So this drug, it will bind with the IgE antibody. This IgE antibody will degranulate these mast cells. From these mast cells, those inflammatory mediators, then allergic mediators, they will get a release. They will produce hypersensitivity reactions. For example, some seasonal allergies, some people will get cold in winter season, then a food allergy kind of thing will happen, type 1. Type 2 is a IgG-mediated cytotoxic hypersensitivity. So here, those Ig first, if you take the drug, it will stimulate antibody production, IgG. This IgG antibody, then it will activate this kind of T cells. T cells, they will kill that our drugs because it will consider that as a antigen because we are giving the drug outside. So our immune body immune system will consider that drug as a antigen. So it will stimulate this T cells. Because of these T cells, they will incubate the drugs. In these conditions, it will release some other allergic and inflammatory mediators. Those will produce hypersensitivity reactions. For example, mismatched blood, like if you're transferring the blood, for kind of example, A positive blood group, if you're giving some B positive, what it will do, it will destroy the blood cells because of this condition. Then type 3 is an immune complex mediated hypersensitivity. Here are the drug under the complementary system. Complement system is one of the immune system. So the drug, it will bind with the antibodies. This form a antigen antibody complex. This complex, they will deposit in the blood vessel and they will stimulate the neutrophils. Because of these neutrophils, it will activate the macrophage and mast cells. It will release the immune mediators. It will happen in the glomerulonephritis, rheumatoid arthritis, then systemic lupus erythematosus. Then type 4 is a delayed hypersensitivity. It is a cell mediated. First, our T helper cells, the drug will go to the T helper cells. It will identify, okay, this is which kind of antigen like that. It will identify. Then it will release the cytokines. Cytokines means they are inflammatory mediators. These inflammatory mediators, then it will activate the macrophage and cytotoxic T cells. These both will produce the inflammatory responses. That is hypersensitivity. It is a type 4. It will happen in the tuberculin reaction, dermatitis, contacted dermatitis, autoimmune disease, rheumatoid arthritis. So here the type 4 delayed hypersensitivity will happen. This is a short form. Then type 1 is an immediate type. It is developed within the minutes and it will last for 2 to 3 years due to IgE antibodies, for example, penicillin and streptokinase. If you give those drugs, a patient may develop allergy reactions within a minute. Then type 2. Type 2 is an accelerated allergy. That is, first an antibody will get stimulated, then it will stimulate the cytotoxic T cells, cytotoxic hypersensitivity. It will occur within 72 hours. Then type 3 is an immune complex mediated. It will occur after 72 hours, but within 1 to 2 weeks it will happen. Then type 4 is a delayed. It's a cell mediator. Delayed means after 1 to 2 weeks it will happen. How to treat this hypersensitivity? 2, 3, and 4. They can be treated with hydrocortisone or prednisolone intravenously. But type 1, they have to be treated with injection nadunarin 1 in 1000 solution, 0.3 to 0.5 ml IM we have to give, then hydrocortisone 100 to 200 mg IV, then injection diphenhydramine 25 to 50 mg IM we have to give to treat the type 1 hypersensitivity. Next one, 2B, genetically determined abnormal responses of the drug. So it's genetically determined. So we can't expect this kind of side effect will happen in some patients. So if two people are there, they are taking the same drug, but one patient will develop some adverse drug reactions, but other patient will be normal because their genes. So one person's gene will be normal, another person's gene will be somewhat different for that drug. That's why that fellow developed some adverse drug reactions. So for example, many drugs, they are metabolized by the hepatic N-acetylase enzymes. Okay, in that, there are two kind of people, like for example, Japanese and the Egyptians. So in that Japanese, they are rapid acetylators. So Japanese people, if I'm giving isoniazid drug to these kind of these two group of peoples, so one group people Japanese, another group people Egyptians. So this isoniazid, these Japanese people, they are rapid acetylators. So rapid acetylators means they will acetylate the isoniazid very fast. So they will metabolize this isoniazid because they are metabolized very faster. So it will lead to higher concentration of metabolic product called acetylhydrazine. This acetylhydrazine is a hepatotoxic molecule. So it will produce hepatotoxicity. So it is a different. If those Egyptian people, they are slow acetylators, so they will take isoniazid, but it will be metabolized very slowly. So it will get accumulated and it will produce neurotoxicity. So same drug isoniazid, but Japanese people will develop hepatotoxicity. Egyptian people, they will develop neurotoxicity. So this is called genetically determined abnormal response. We can't expect it. Then some people in African and American Negroes people, they have a glucose 6 phosphate dehydrogenase enzyme deficiency in the body. Because of that one, primaquine, sulfonamide, nitrofurantoin. If those people taking primaquine, sulfonamide, nitrofurantoin, they will lead to hemolysis. Because this G6PD enzyme, it will protect hemolysis from the primaquine, sulfonamide, nitrofurantoin. If there is a deficiency in these people, it will lead to hemolysis. So next one, idiosyncratic drug responses. Idiosyncratic meaning, literal meaning, they don't know what is the cause, how it happened. That mechanism, we don't know. So it is a harmful and a fatal complications, reactions. The cause, poorly understood, we don't know how.
For example, malignant hyperpyrexia. This halothane, haloperidol, chlorpromazine, for example, they will produce a malignant hyperpyrexia. Then chloramphenicol, it will produce aplastic anemia. But we don't know the exact reason, exact mechanism, how they are developing, like a chloramphenicol causing aplastic anemia, we don't know. So third one, others. In that others, as I already told, type C, D, E, F. So C is a chronic effect. Like if the patient taking prednisone a long time, it will produce Cushing syndrome. This is chronic effect. Then D, delayed effect. Delayed effect, it may occur due to treatment. For example, teratogenic drugs. Okay, here the mother will take some drugs like steroids or some ferritin, something. But later on, like for example, thalidomide, these drugs, it will produce effect in the baby. That is delayed effect. Then type E. E is an end of treatment effect. End of treatment means like if the patient taking propranolol for the hypertension, suddenly if he withdraw the drug, suddenly he discontinue the drug, it will produce rebound hypertension. So it is occur when a drug suddenly discontinued. Example, rebound hypertension after abrupt withdrawal of propranolol. Then type F. So here failure of the drug, F failure, E end, D delayed, C chronic. We have to remember this one. So failure of the drug to produce the desired effect due to some unknown reasons, we don't know exactly. Because we will give the drug, but it won't produce the effect. But the mechanism, we don't know. That is F. Some specific toxicities due to the drugs. Okay, previous these things are some adverse drug reactions. But here, these drugs will have the specific toxicity to the drug. Like, for example, teratogenicity, this thalidomide, warfarin, phenytoin, confirm they will produce teratogenicity. That is specific to that one. Then doxorubicin, if you take, confirm it will produce cardiotoxicity. So that is a specific toxicity due to the drugs. Then our alkali toxicity caused by the chloroquine, ethambutol. Then hepatotoxicity, paracetamol, rifampicin, erythromycin, isoniazid. Confirm they will produce hepatotoxicity. That is specific. Then isoniazid, neurotoxicity. Renal toxicity by NSAID, AC inhibitors, aminoglycosides. Then ototoxicity caused by the aminoglycosides and chloroquine. Okay. Next, we will see about the general principles of treatment of poisoning. Okay, in case the poison to the person took poison, so what we have to do? How to recover the patient from the poisoning condition? First, the main goal to prevent the systemic absorption of the poison. Okay, how the patient took the poison, like through the mouth, we have to decontaminate the GIT. Okay, by decontaminating the skin, eyes, GIT is compulsory. Because if it is in the skin, eyes also, they will get absorbed into the body. GIT, of course, they will absorb into the vessels. So we have to decontaminate in these areas perfectly. So the affected area, our skin parts, then behind the ears, we have to clean. Because we will forget these areas, behind the ears, under the nails, and the skin folds we will miss. So we have to clean these areas also. They have to be thoroughly washed with lukewarm water or saline. Lukewarm water means like a small warm water, not hot, not a normal water, somewhat hot. That is a warm water we have to use, or saline. For oily poisons, they will stick to the skin. So we have to wash with twice with soap. Then our hair should be, we have to use shampoo to clean the hair also. Then our both eyes, they should be flushed with more amount of water or saline under local anesthesia, because we have that feeling. So if you apply local anesthesia lignocaine drops, then you can wash your eyes with this water or saline. So then for GIT decontamination, our intestinal tract decontamination, we can use inducing emesis, gastric lavage, then a whole bowel irrigation, then cathartics. Cathartics I will tell later what is. So we can use these methods to decontaminate the GIT. So here emesis. Emesis and a vomiting. Okay, we will give, to induce vomiting, we will give syrup of ipecac. the syrup, it is a very convenient and effective. It should be given within 30 minutes of ingestion of poison. But it should be avoided in the unconscious patient, because unconscious patient, they can't drink. So in those patients, we have to avoid. Then who ingested, like who took a petroleum product or corrosive poison, acid or alkali, something if he took, we should avoid. Because if he vomit this kind of a product, it will aspirate into the lungs. So because of aspiration, we may lose the patient. So in that kind of cases, we have to avoid. This is syrup of apricot. So the dose is 30 ml in 250 ml of water. We have to take 250 ml of water. In that 30 ml apricot syrup, we have to add, we have to drink. Not we, like a patient. After that, the patient get vomit, then these poisons will get out. So this is the apricot syrup, sir, emetic 30 ml. Then gastric lavage. Gastric lavage, it is a very effective for the liquid and the powder form of the poison. It is useful when started within 60 minutes of ingestion. It is useful if emesis is failed. Okay, when we can use, if emesis method is failed or emesis is contraindicated, because previously I told you it is contraindicated, unconscious patient, petroleum product, corrosive poisons, here we can use. Then gastric content needed for identification, because we need content, what is a poison, we have to identify. For that kind of purpose, we can use gastric lavage. Then cathartics. Cathartics, they will stimulate peristalsis. They will stimulate the intestinal movement. For that, 10% magnesium sulfate we can use, or 70% sorbitol also we can use. It will stimulate the peristalsis. So the intestinal movement is increased or stimulated. Because of that one, it will speed up the elimination of unabsorbed poison. Okay, whatever the poison or activated charcoal, slurry. Slurry means some waste product. It will speed up the elimination of the unabsorbed poison. Then whole bubble irrigation. Whole bubble irrigation means like entire intestinal tract will be cleaned. For that, we will use large volume of balanced polyethylene glycol and electrolyte solution. Because if you cleaning a whole GIT, we have to see about the electrolyte balance also. For that, we have to give balanced polyethylene glycol and electrolyte solution we have to give. So it will clean it mechanically, it will cleanse the entire intestinal tract. It is preferred in the massive iron tablets ingestion. So some people, they will take some 100 iron tablets at the same time. Those conditions, then sustained release tablets, then entry coated tablets. In these conditions, we can use whole bubble irrigation. In that all poisoning, mostly we will use this activated charcoal. Let's see about activated charcoal. It is used mostly to decontaminate GID. It effectively absorbs almost all drugs and poisons. If you give activated charcoal, these kind of drugs or poison, they will stick to the charcoal and they will get eliminated through the anus. So it is not used in the cyanide, corrosives, iron, lithium, alcohol poisoning. In these conditions, we should not use. Then it should not be used in comatose patient or convulsing patient. The patient having seizure or patient in coma, unconscious state, then also we should not use this activated charcoal. It is contraindicated in the intestinal obstruction. Because if there is intestinal obstruction, this cannot be get eliminated. So it is contraindicated in intestinal obstruction. This is activated charcoal, then charcoal powder available. The dose 0.5 to 2 gram per kg. We have to give maximum, we can give 100 mg. It can be administered orally or by the gastric tube, mixed in water slurry. That a repeated dose should be given to accelerate the elimination of some drugs, like a digoxin, theophylline. For these kind of drugs, we have to give some repeated dose also. It is called a gut dialysis. Then MSS are purgatives. Purgatives means like they will stimulate release of feces. Like for example, drugs producing diarrhea. That is a purgatives. MSS and purgatives, they are not used concomitantly with the activated charcoal. because this activated charcoal, they will absorb those emetic drugs also. So those drugs cannot produce the effect. Like if emissions, it should produce vomiting. But if you give activated charcoal at the same time, it will absorb that emetic drug also. So it won't produce vomiting. So that's why they should not be used at the same time. Then urinary manipulations. Urinary manipulation, sometimes these drugs are poisons. So they can be removed by urinary manipulations like hemodialysis, peritoneal dialysis, hemoperfusion. Then another one, like in case the patient took so much acidic drugs, for example, salicylate, aspirin, barbiturate, phenobarbital, these kind of drugs. So these are acidic drugs. So if you make the urine as an alkali by giving sodium bicarbonate like that, if you give, our urine will become alkaline. So these are acidic drugs. This urine become alkaline. Both they will react and they will excreted through the urine. At the like same basic drugs like amphetamine or morphine, atropine, these are basic drugs. If you make the urine acidic, these basic drugs, they will mingle with this acidic urine and they will get excreted. For this purpose also we can do. Then hemodialysis is a very effective method. It's a final last method. Then we will see about treatment of alcohol and OPC poisoning. First, we will see about alcohol poisoning. It's the most common. Like alcohol poisoning, we can tell another name, alcohol intoxication. Suddenly, the person drinking so much of alcohol, at the time, it will produce some signs and symptoms. So these are the beverages and their alcohol percentage. If you take rum, it has 42.8% of alcohol. Then whiskey, brandy, 42.8%. Then gin, 37.2 to 42.8% alcohol. Wines, 8 to 15.5%. Beer, 2 to 10%. Then country liquor. Country liquor is 11.4 to 45.7%. Most highest alcohol percentage these are having. Okay, what are the symptoms of alcohol poisoning? There will be a confusion. Potential seizures can occur, vomiting, then pale or bluish skin, then trouble walking. Because we know drunkard people, how they will walk, how they will confuse, they will get vomiting, all those things. Signs also same, vomiting, pale skin, passing out, irregular breathing, seizures, confusion. These are signs and symptoms. And how we are going to treat acute alcohol intoxication? That alcohol is ethanol only. Ethanol, now the people are drinking. Okay, first we have to ensure the ABC. What is ABC? Airway, breathing, circulation. We have to protect the airway and we have to enhance the breathing. We have to see the circulation. Then we have to prevent the aspiration of vomitous content. If the patient taking vomiting, at the time suddenly they can aspirate into the lungs. It will produce aspiration, pneumonia. So we have to prevent that one also. Then if there is electrolyte imbalance, we have to correct. If there is less potassium, we have to give for KCL syrup like that. Then treat hypoglycemia and the ketosis. Because of this alcohol, it will produce a more hypoglycemia and ketoacidosis. For that, we have to give glucose intravenously. Then injection time in IV or IM, we have to give to prevent the Wernicke's and Korsakoff syndrome. Because our alcohol, It will inhibit the enzyme needed for synthesis of thymine. Thymine is a very, very important one for our neuronal stability. So during alcohol intoxication, this thymine will become very, very low. Because of that one, it will produce Wernicke-Korsakoff syndrome. That syndrome, it has ataxia kind of thing. So to prevent that one, we have to give thymine injection. So this is how we have to treat the patient. At the same time, we have to monitor the vital signs. Based on the symptoms and the vital signs, we have to give the proper treatment. Then organophosphorus poisoning. Organophosphorus compounds, these are compounds isofluorophate, eicothiophate, paroxone, parathion, malathion, carbaryl. So mostly these compounds, they are used in the insecticide and the pesticides, mostly farming cultures we are using these drugs as a insecticide and a pesticide. So this poisoning due to occupational, like farmers, they are using insecticide to the farm lands. During that exposure, they can get through the occupational or accidental. Accidentally, some persons accidentally they took, or it can be a suicidal. Because of that one, it will produce so much effect. How the organophosphate poisoning happen? Actually, this is a presynaptic neuron. This is the postsynaptic neurons. Here we have muscarinic receptor, nicotinic receptor. So both are acetylcholine receptors. From presynaptic neuron, acetylcholines are released. After release, they will be destroyed by the acetylcholine esterase enzyme. So this acetylcholine esterase enzyme, they will degrade this acetylcholine into acetate and choline. So this is how normally it will happen. But organophosphates, they are acetylcholine esterase inhibitors. So this is the organophosphate. This organophosphate, they will inhibit this acetylcholine esterase enzyme. So because of that one, this acetylcholine will become more, because it will increase the acetylcholine in the synaptic cleft. So there will be an overstimulation of acetylcholine receptors. It will produce the signs and symptoms of poisoning. So here, organophosphate, they will degrade this acetylcholine esterase enzyme. So I am saved. So acetylcholine will be more in the synaptic cleft. So it will overstimulate the postsynaptic neurons. It can be occupational exposure. Mostly in the farmers, it will happen. Then organophosphate, what are the symptoms? It will act on the muscarinic receptor or the nicotinic receptor. They are get overstimulated. So because I'm overstimulated, they will produce the symptoms, sludge for mnemonic. In that sludge, there will be S for salivation, L for lacrimation, U for urination, D for defecation, G for GI cramps, E for emesis. It will produce these kind of symptoms with the muscarinic receptors. Nicotinic receptors, tension, weakness, paralysis. So tension, hypertension, then weakness, muscle weakness, then paralysis. It will happen with the nicotinic receptor overstimulation. So this is how the organophosphorus poison, these patients will come. They will produce with these kind of symptoms. Then how we are going to treat? So first we have to remove the soiled cloth and we have to wash the skin with the soap and water for at least 10 minutes to prevent the absorption, because through skin also they can get absorbed. So we have to wash with the soap and water for 10 minutes. Then contamination of ice, we have to wash the ice also. Then put the patient in the prone position, because the patient having so much salivation, lacrimation, then vomiting. So because of these condition, because of these symptoms, the patient may get aspirate. So to prevent that one, we have to put the patient in a prone position. Then the head down and the one side to the protect the airway. Then clear the mouth and the pharynx with the suction. If there is a more secretions, we have to give suction and we have to clean. Then if there is an airway obstruction, we have to give nasopharyngeal or endotracheal intubation should be done. Like we have to intubate the patient if there is a more obstruction, airway obstruction. Then we have to give gastric lavage, because those organophosphorus compounds inside the intestine, they can get absorbed and they will produce more effect. So to prevent that one, we have to give gastric lavage. Then medical pharmacological treatment, we have to give atropine sulfate 2 to 4 mg. Then injection, pralidaxim, 1 to 2 gram, slow IV. This atropine is an anticholinergic drug. So then atropine injection, it should be repeated till the patient get the recover. So till the patient get recover conscious, we have to give atropine injection. Then atropine, pralidaxim. What is the mechanism? We will see. Atropine is an anticholinergic drug. So atropine, what they will do, they will bind here this muscarinic receptor and the nicotinic receptor. So because of that one, this acetylcholine, they can't come and bind here. So that is the action of atropine. Then pralidoxin is a organophosphate. They will degrade or inactivate this acetylcholine esterase enzyme. But the pralidoxin, they will activate this acetylcholine esterase enzyme. So here organophosphate, they are acetylcholine esterase inhibitors. Pralidoxin, they are acetylcholine esterase activators. So they will activate this pralidoxin. It will activate the acetylcholine esterase enzyme. Because of that one, it will degrade more acetylcholine. That's how these two drugs are working. So this is organophosphorus poisoning. Thank you. Okay, if you have any doubt, just comment below the video. Thank you.